Catherine Russell, Assistant Director of the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics here at the University of Pittsburgh, and a Research Assistant Professor in the English Department. I've been dreaming of this event for over a year since my interview for this position. Before I knew if I would get the job, before I knew what the center would become or much about the logistics of making this happen, before I had any idea of what political moment we would now be inhabiting or what losses I might now be grieving. When, as a candidate for the position, I was asked what events I'd like to see at the center, I said, "Has anyone read Sonya Posmentier's essay in the New York Times?" Did I mispronounce your name?
No.
Sorry. In that essay, A Language for Grieving, Posmentier describes her visit to the Whitney Plantation Museum in Louisiana, a site of memory focused on the lives of the enslaved people who lived and labored there. The museum's director of research is Ibrahima Seck, who is also a professor in the history department of Cheikh Anta Diop University in Dakar, Senegal. In turning the plantation into a memorial site and reorienting it to highlight the perspective of the enslaved, the owner and museum director constructed an architecture for grief, Posmentier writes. Can poetry do the same? She goes on to discuss how, by making violence strange and unfamiliar, poets like M. Nourbese Philip have gone beyond merely repeating its effects, like a viral video of a police shooting, and beyond the realm of the evidentiary to that of the imagination, where we might not only observe violence, but mourn and encounter it. M. Nourbese Philip's extended poem cycle, Zong, is based on the text of the legal decision Gregson versus Gilbert, the only extant public document related to the murder of 150 Africans aboard the slave ship Zong in 1781. In an interview in Room magazine, Philip writes that archives are often very one-sided, having been constructed and preserved by the very people who were responsible for destroying the cultures and histories of so many peoples. She continues, "Hence my interest in the archive of silence, the archive of the gap, the archive of the space, the archive of the erased space, the archive of the rupture." My readings in contemporary poetry class has been discussing Zong these last couple weeks. In a discussion board post, one of my students wrote that books like Zong are not just going backward into the archive and dancing with or confronting archives, but are also establishing themselves alongside them and becoming part of something that is still being created and continuing to go on. When this idea came up in class discussion, another student got up and went to the board and drew a graph. If the y-axis is the present, dividing the x-axis into what occurred in the past and what will occur in the future, she said, then imagination is another field that exists off the board, influencing and being influenced by the activity on the graph while existing in its own dimension. Today, a moment that has leaped from the dimension of the imagination right onto the present point where the axes meet, we welcome M. Nourbese Philip, Sonya Posmentier, and Ibrahima Seck to consider questions of mourning and imagination and the challenges of working with one-sided archives. How might the archive, as a site of memory, provide or fail to provide an architecture for grief? My colleague Imani Owens, Assistant Professor of English, will introduce Sonya Posmentier. Sonya will be followed by Robert Bland, Visiting Assistant Professor of African American History, introducing Ibrahima Seck. Don Lundy Martin, co-director of the center, will introduce M. Nourbese Philip. And after Nourbese reads, she will join Sonya and Ibrahima in a moderated discussion followed by a Q&A. There are books for sale in the anteroom. There's going to be a book signing after the event. Stick around. Please join me in welcoming M. Nourbese Philip, Sonya Posmentier, and Ibrahima Seck to the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics and the University of Pittsburgh. Imani Owens.
Thanks, Lauren, for that beautiful introduction. Good night, everyone. So I'm Imani. I'm assistant professor English here at Pitt, and it's really my pleasure to introduce Sonya Posmentier. Sonya is an assistant professor of English at New York University, where she works on Black literature and culture. She holds a PhD in English from Princeton and an MFA in creative writing in poetry from the University of Oregon. Sonya and I met at a Caribbean Studies Association conference in New Orleans, not very far from the Whitney Plantation Museum, and I just learned that it was during that conference that you made your first visit to the museum. So in many ways, this conversation today brings us full circle. New Orleans, of course, resonates in another way as a city at the crossroads of the South and the Caribbean, a space for the confluence of Black celebration and grief, truly a site of memory if there ever was one. So many of these concerns animate Sonya's book, which is forthcoming from John Hopkins in June, and it's titled Cultivation and Catastrophe, the Lyric Ecology of Modern Black Literature. In that book, Sonya argues that environmental experiences of growth and rupture define the literature of Black freedom, an archive that ranges from sonnets, mini epics, documentary poems, periodicals and novels to blues songs, dance hall productions, and ethnographic writing. Posmentier examines how writers and artists, including Gwendolyn Brooks, Bessie Smith, Sterling Brown, Kamaru Brathwaite, and others, give voice to racialized experiences of alienation from the land, while simultaneously envisioning a modern poetics of survival, repair, and generation. So her articles and essays have appeared in a number of venues, American Literature, A Companion to the Harlem Renaissance, Race and Real Estate, and the New York Times Book Review. And her latest project is a book tentatively titled Black Reading that revisits the supposed culture wars of the late 20th century by making earlier Black epistemology and Black lyrics the center of the story of modern Black literary criticism's development as a discipline. And I say this unabashedly, Sonya's work for me offers a model of scholarly writing that is attentive to the possibilities of language, its captivating restraint, its evocative force, and above all, its openness. So I'm very pleased to invite her to the stage tonight. Please join me in welcoming Sonya.
Thank you so much, Lauren and Imani, for both of those incredible introductions and for making this event happen. And thank you, Nourbese and Ibrahim, for being here with me. If someone ever had asked me what conversation would you most like to have and with whom, this would be it. So it's really a dream for me to be here. And thank you also to the center and to the English department. Lauren asked me to talk a little bit about some of my research and then offer some framing questions for our discussion, so that's what I'll do. So in the book that I've recently completed, Cultivation Catastrophe, with which Imani described so well, I talk about poetry in particular as a kind of archive for cultural, historical, and environmental experience in response to the threats of social and environmental catastrophe. And the focus of that book is on poetry, but it concludes after an extended discussion of Zong with the image of Mark Bradford's plywood ship, Mithra, which was his contribution to the 2009 New Orleans Biennial in response to Hurricane Katrina. This final meditation left me wondering how ephemeral, sometimes durational, site-specific visual art installations through which we can move our bodies and in which we can interact with other people, reimagine the physical spaces of enslavement, abolition, and reconstruction in the present, and how they provide visual, oral, haptic, and kinetic languages for grieving and for growth. These site-specific visual art practices will be my focus in the new work that I'm sharing today. So the questions that I've been asking about the relationships among poetry, environment, and history draw me, of course, to Nourbese Philip's poetry and to the historical work of Ibrahim Seck. And a related set of questions draws me to the two works I'll consider in the rest of this talk. Kara Walker's A Subtlety, or The Marvelous Sugar Baby, and Black Radical Brooklyn Funk God, Jazz, and Medicine, both art installations curated in New York City. Oh, did we just lose this? I'm sorry, I got it. We're good, okay. Sorry, these are both art installations curated by Creative Time, a public arts organization in New York. Both of the works draw upon a reparative aesthetics in relationship to historical slavery, and specifically the space of the plantation, but they also invite us to rethink environmental relation as a process of ongoing reconstruction. I'm sure many of you are familiar with Kara Walker's much lauded, much debated 2014 transformation of Brooklyn's Domino Sugar Factory on the eve of that warehouse's demolition to make room for condos, A Subtlety, or The Marvelous Sugar Baby. The title, Subtlety, refers to small medieval sugar sculptures that were displayed and then consumed at aristocratic banquets. And the centerpiece of the show was this larger-than-life sphinx covered in sugar, rising to fill the high ceilings of the former sugar refinery. Surrounded in the warehouse, this is another shot from the front, by life-sized resin statues of children carrying various implements, including baskets overflowing with syrup. Walker's piece invited engagement with the history and iconography of the transatlantic trade in people and sugar by placing viewers face to face with an enlarged, embodied figure of that history. And here she is again. One of the most notable features of the installation was its durational qualities. It changed over time. So the show opened on May 10th and ran through July 6th of 2014. And over the course of that nearly 2 months, the Sphinx shape stayed visibly the same. And this was at least in part through the use of pesticides. But the resin and sugar child statues were melted, disintegrated, amputated, and felled by time. In this sense, the work symbolically intertwines the fate of the human body and the non-human products of enforced cultivation, and also insists on the ongoingness of physical, social, and environmental death in the forms of child labor, diabetes, and familial rupture. Some scholars and critics have said that this work remains conscripted within the framework of the plantation as a space of social death, and perhaps also overly circumscribed by stereotype. And it's perhaps in this framework that many have read Walker's notorious afterword to the work, which was the follow-up show at her gallery in Sekema Jenkins, including a film with shots of people watching and interacting with the installation. Many people have read it as a sort of deeply cynical project. Maybe the most kind of well-known aspect of it was that people responded to the statue by taking a lot of selfies that were sexually explicit and at times racist, and posting them on various social media. And Walker was filming this taking place the whole time it was happening. So when the gallery revealed that they had been watching us, that in Walker's words, I was spying, by collecting the selfies and filming the factory for the purposes of the afterword, most media pundits assumed that the resulting film would be a kind of unsubtle I gotcha, reflecting the changing same of American racism. So for instance, the title of one review, I think it was on Flavor Wire, was Kara Walker knew people would take dumb selfies with a subtlety and that shouldn't surprise us. That was the point. Right, was sort of the argument of that piece. In a minute, I'll suggest another way to understand her engagement with the audience reception, but I'm gonna detour to the other art installation I wanna talk about first. If Walker's A Subtlety asks viewers to witness the monumentalization of a certain stereotypical image of the slave past in the US South, the works in the subsequent large public art project produced by Creative Time foreground instead Black self-determination in the context of a different historical moment, Reconstruction. In Black Radical Brooklyn, Funk God, Jazz, and Medicine, featuring work by four artists on four sites in the Bedford Stuyvesant and Crown Heights neighborhoods of Brooklyn, Reconstruction is more than a historical period, 1866 to 1877, bound to a particular place, the southern states of the United States, but rather an imagining of several versions of Black self-determination that depend upon transnational constructions of identity and community, while also remaining site-specific. So the work I'm going to focus on was done under the heading of Funk, and was produced in partnership with the Weeksville Heritage Center, a center dedicated to the preservation of a Brooklyn community that was established by free and formerly enslaved citizens just 11 years after the abolition of slavery in New York State, when these houses were discovered in the late 60s and excavated. This is one of the historic houses. The very existence of the Weeksville community itself signals the need for a more expansive notion of the periods and places of Reconstruction. As a northern free Black farming community founded after abolition in New York, but 25 years before the Emancipation Proclamation, Weeksville represents both the expanded geography and the elongated temporality of the work of Reconstruction. Even as the fight for abolition continued, the freedmen and women of Weeksville were engaged in a process of Reconstruction that depended on economic, agricultural, and educational self-determination. For instance, in the 19th century, the Weeksville community was also the home of the African Civilization Society, an early cultural nationalist movement that advocated a return to Africa, as well as a politics connecting the local struggles of African Americans with struggles of Black people elsewhere in the world. And I'm reminded here of Dr. Seck's work on how enslaved people in Louisiana retained such connections through foodways and other cultural practices, and these were also kind of evoked in the community at Weeksville. Of the four sites in Funk God, Jazz, and Medicine, the work of Zenobia Bailey, the artist who engaged in this installation, and the high school students she worked with from the local high school, Boys and Girls School, most explicitly engages this expanded history of Reconstruction. Bailey's installation took over one of these houses, and along with the students, she refurnished the house with found materials and household tools. I'm going to show you a couple of examples of this. I'll talk about this a little more in a second. But on one of the homemade corrugated cardboard tables that she designed and built, this one's made out of a laundry soap box, lay a copy with the paperback cover torn off of W.E.B. Du Bois's Black Reconstruction in America. Black Reconstruction, which was first published in 1935, itself invites this kind of expanded temporal framework for thinking about Reconstruction, and demonstrates the connection between Reconstruction and abolition. His emphasis really is on the efforts of enslaved and free Black workers in creating their own freedom. Such free men and women, Du Bois argued, struggled not only against toil, but also against the cultural impoverishment of the South. Up from this slavery, wrote Du Bois, gradually climbed the free Negro with clearer modern expression and more definite aim long before the emancipation of 1863. His greatest effort lay in his cooperation with the abolition movement. He knew he was not free until all Negroes were free. In the reference to Du Bois, Bailey's work marks the disjunction between the promise of political Reconstruction and its fulfillment. And I think that's a disjunction that really speaks to us in our current historical moment. And it extends the project of Reconstruction to 1935, the date of Du Bois' book, 1975, which is the date of this actual edition, and to the present moment, marked by the opening of the grand modern edifice of the Weeksville Heritage Center at one edge of the property. Reconstruction takes on a formal and material quality in the funk aesthetic of Bailey's installation. Chairs and tables, wallpaper, paper curtains, a woven magazine quilt, and a stunning shrine to freedom, all made from recycled materials, furnishing the restored house. And she talked about wanting to teach the high school students with whom she was working to be able to build things with their own hands as sort of part of her mission with this project. And I think of Bailey's project as an ecological one as well, insofar as funk for Bailey is an aesthetic of recycling and reuse, connecting a symbolic sense of reconstruction with the ethos of self-determination that pervaded the historical period. If Du Bois wished to underscore at every turn the agency of Black laborers in producing their own freedom and mining the land for its products, Bailey's work similarly underscores the material possibilities of Black work. But unlike the resource-intensive and earth-exhausting processes of cultivation to which a subtlety alludes, Bailey's project seeks to make use of existing resources in what she calls a functional way. Bailey reimagines Black reconstruction beyond the temporal borders of Du Bois's text and gestures toward Du Bois's global reach to recycle, if you will, his transnational context for the 21st century, drawing a line from the post-plantation site of experimental freedom in the US to the post-colonial Caribbean. Bailey noted in conversation with visitors on the day that I was there that a majority of the students she worked with on the building project from the high school are Caribbean American and in particular Haitian American. And according to Bailey, most of them had been born in the US and had little contact with Haitian art and design principles, but she encouraged them to research and study those traditions as one basis for the work they produced together. And the shrine is one of the examples that she pointed to of that sort of collaboration and research. So Bailey sees the project as an opportunity to draw a connection between the ecological work of recycling, the functional work of building and housing, and also the cultural work of preserving and continuing across time and space. The shrine's inclusion of an 1866 issue of the Freedmen's Torchlight, right? So an issue of a publication dedicated to abolition, but after abolition has finally been achieved, right? Exemplifies how the work of freedom necessarily extends beyond legal and political emancipation. The words all natural seem to refer both earnestly to the earth-saving ethos of recycling and ironically to the global waste-producing ethos of processing and packaging domestic goods. The work brings together acts of cultural and ecological preservation, highlighting how Brooklyn's landscape and architecture function as historical archive, but also how they supply a future tense, a sense of possibility. Outside the windows of the Hunter Fly Road houses is a small vegetable garden maintained on the site. And over the course of the exhibition, Weeksville and the other sites offered workshops on everything from beekeeping to yoga and a free medical clinic featuring HIV and cholesterol testing. So I started out thinking of these two works, Kara Walker's and Zenobia Bailey's, in terms of opposition between Walker's engagement with the historical framework of slavery and Bailey's with the historical framework of Reconstruction. More than a shift in historical reference, this opposition also marks a difference between the haunted space of social death and the optimistic possibilities of self-determination. And there's also an accompanying difference in scope and scale. Walker's installation was concentrated at one symbolic site of Sugar's power, the refinery, making the domestic subtlety into a monument or a memorial. But the Funk God Jazz and Medicine exhibit was dispersed across borders of a now vanished communities, Weeksville. But it also involved work by, in, and for the contemporary communities living in those spaces. So in that sense, it was not only a space of memorial or grief or mourning, but also of living. But I think in spite of these meaningful differences, we might read Walker's work too as shaped by Reconstruction. And this is Walker and Bailey together in that space. Walker's approach to Reconstruction is visible in the gap between the cynical observation that she anticipated bad behavior in her viewers and the work she actually made out of the footage she had collected over the life of the piece. In an interview, Walker describes her plans for the collected selfies and footage in a positive light that isn't very often noted by critics and reviewers. She says, "I want to tell about the gathering of this piece. Overall, it was a very positive environment. Large groups of people came, families came, grandmothers came, little kids, things that don't happen very often around contemporary art. And I think it's also worth noting that there were like large movements of organized groups of people of color deciding to inhabit this space, right? And sort of work against the selfie taking that was going on. And this is indeed the story that's actually told by the film, and I'm just gonna actually play it with no sound in the background. So you can get a sense of it. Among other things, the film captures a representation of a monumental African woman who or which is at the same time sugar, an enormous product of transnational agricultural labor, in the process of being adored, revered, feared, gazed at, loved, and finally touched, stroked, smelled, and tasted by other black, brown, and white bodies. I'm going to move toward the end. For the last 2 hours of the production, viewers were allowed to touch the sculpture. And the film ends with a series of hands, black and brown hands, gently caressing the dimpled sugar, and then the factory void of other bodies. Only the sugar baby and one of the sugar children alight in the cage of the warehouse's steel beams. There's then an abrupt cut, which I can't show you, unfortunately, because I don't have it, between this first film and audience and the subsequent film, Rhapsody, which dramatizes the sugar baby's demolition, in which we watch large machines burn, melt, cut into, and take down this curiously embodied history. Somehow, between her objectification and her scorching amputation and decapitation, this subtlety has been restored to radiance through the tactile love of an audience. But the restoration doesn't take place through a successful material reconstitution of a body that has been exploited, damaged, and finally destroyed. There's no way to repair that. Instead, Walker renders the ephemeral as the object of study and even of love. She insists, but the gist of the piece was that it wouldn't be rebuilt again, that it would never happen again. It was ephemeral. You build these monuments, but they're really castles in the sand. It's like sugar. It evaporates and goes away. I'm trying to understand the sort of absence of the piece through the beginning stages. In this way, Walker engages reconstruction, that period of history that was a castle in the sand, like sugar, that we must understand as an absence by viewing it through the beginning stages. The Sphinx and her children are not necessarily representations of people, but figures for our approaches to history, our desires to reconstitute, resist, or destroy the past, and reconstruct or preserve the vanishing present of the world in which we live. So by way of opening onto our two other presentations, I'll conclude by mentioning that I began working on this piece just after a visit to the Whitney Plantation in Louisiana in May 2015, when I was there for the Caribbean Studies Association Conference. And during that same period that I was writing this piece, I was composing the piece for the New York Times Book Review that Lauren mentioned about what I see as Nourbese Philip and Ibrahim Seck's shared project of developing a language for mourning and repair. It's therefore a special honor to offer the work here in conversation with them. Their work invites us to ask, how do poetry, history, and orchestrations of movement through physical space differently engage and transform the limitations of the archive? And how does writing, which apparently takes up the history and archive of slavery, also allow us to imagine practices of freedom, which I think both of their work does? By thinking of poetry alongside site-specific art practices, history writing, and architectural and landscape projects, we might pay even greater attention to poetry's spatial and durational qualities, as Nourbese Philip's work already so profoundly does. Or, to borrow Dr. Seck's words about the Whitney Plantation, we might discover more ways of making history an open book. Thank you.
So by way of introduction, my name is Robert Bland. I'm a scholar of Reconstruction and American Memory. So I really appreciated Sonya's discussion of the various ways Reconstruction appears and disappears in American memory. I may borrow that phrase, castles in the sand, for my book title. I appreciate that. There you go. I'm really excited to introduce Professor Seck for his talk, because I feel like we're in a moment of African-American public memory. Not only the important work that the Whitney Museum is doing as the first museum dedicated to the history of American slavery and the American landscape, but a number of other kind of monuments and museums dedicated to history. Obviously, we know that National Museum of African American History in Washington, D.C., which is the hottest ticket in town in Washington right now. Has anyone gotten a chance to see the African American History Museum? It's a fantastic museum, and you can't possibly see it in one day. In Beaufort County, South Carolina, we've kind of had Barack Obama in the last days of his presidency use the Antiquities Act to dedicate the first museum on the U.S. soil to Reconstruction. So the kind of idea of Reconstruction, this moment between 1865 to 1877, incredibly difficult to remember, incredibly painful, challenges our very fundamental narratives about who we are as a nation. We've gone over 150 years and there's no memorials to that landscape, on the landscape to remember Reconstruction. When we think about lynching and Bryan Stevenson's work with the Justice Project and beginning to build landscapes for lynching on the American landscape, among other sites and other ways of thinking about public history, I think Dr. Seck's work is particularly helpful in thinking about it in this moment of public history, thinking about how we remember the Black past. Ibrahim Seck is a member of the History Department of Czech and to Jop University of Dakar, Senegal. His research is mostly devoted to the historical and cultural links between the West Africa and Louisiana, with a special interest for religious beliefs, music, and foodways, and miscellaneous aspects of folklore. In 1999, he defended a doctoral dissertation entitled African Culture and Slavery from the Lower Mississippi Valley from Iberville to Jim Crow. Dr. Seck is also the collaborator of the West Africa Research Center located in Dakar, Senegal, where he initiated the Buki Blues Festival in 2002. This festival and other events are many opportunities which allow him to connect West African musicians and musicians from the U.S. South. Dr. Seck is now holding the position of the Director of Research at the Whitney Plantation of Museum of Slavery, which is located between Wallace and Edgar in St. John the Baptist Parish in Louisiana. He is the author of a book on the historic site entitled Buki Fat Gambo, A History of the Slave Community Habitation Idaho, 1750 to 1860. Please give a round of applause as we introduce you.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm really happy to be here tonight and to talk to you about this sacred ground called the Whitney Plantation. The Whitney Plantation is a very special place where, at the very beginning, the owner, John Cummings, of Irish descent, decided that it should be a place where the people who built the original wealth of this country and also contributed tremendously to the shaping of the culture, where these people were enslaved, so this place should be a very special place for those people who suffered over there, who lived over there. Unlike the many plantations we have in Louisiana and open to the public, where it is mostly until today about the big house, the masters, and almost nothing for the people who were enslaved there. The Whitney Plantation is located on the German coast of Louisiana. This is the portion of the river somewhere from outside of New Orleans and going west to St. John the Baptist Parish. New Orleans is right there, and here you have the Peret plantation. In fact, it is the location of the Whitney plantation. The Whitney plantation, the name Whitney is not old. It was named Whitney only after the Civil War, when a carpetbagger went down south and bought many plantations. And one of them was the Heidel plantation. And he renamed the plantation after the family of his in-laws, the family where his granddaughter was married, the Whitney family in New York, a very wealthy family. The founder of the so-called Whitney plantation, his name was Ambrose Heidel. He came from Germany in 1721. And he was among thousands of Germans who were brought to Louisiana by the French Company of the West Indies to become settlers, not enslaved. Thousands of them were brought over there, and that's why. And they were settled along the river, somewhere between New Orleans and St. John the Baptist Parish, halfway to Baton Rouge. That's why that portion of the river is called the German coast. You can notice that at the beginning of his career, Ambrose Heidel had only a single pig. And we'll see how over the years he became so wealthy, because he had many people from Africa who worked for him and make him really wealthy. After Ambrose Heidel, two or three generations of the Heidels run the plantation, and maybe the most famous among them was Jean-Jacques Heidel, his younger son. He's the one who built the big house, you'll see later, with money from the indigo. Indigo was the cash crop of Louisiana in the 18th century, and sugarcane became the cash crop of Louisiana in the 19th century. Jean-Jacques Heidel, père, or Jean-Jacques Heidel, senior, lived a long life, and he was in Louisiana when the French owned the colony. He was born in 1744. And in 1774, when he married another German, at that time the colony was under in the hands of the Spanish. That was the Spanish period. The Spanish controlled for about 40 years, from 1763 to 1803. And Jean-Jacques Heidel was there when Thomas Jefferson bought Louisiana, and this is the beginning of the what they call the American period. And Jean-Jacques Heidel retired in 1820. His two sons ran the plantation for 20 years, from 1820 to 1840. And the last Heidel member to run the plantation was a lady who went by the name of Marie Azli Heidel. She was married to Marcelin Heidel, the son of Jean-Jacques Heidel, the father, Jean-Jacques Heidel Sr. What is really amazing about this family, that at the very beginning I told you, the ancestor who was at the origin of the plantation had only one pig as livestock. But when Marie Azli Heidel was the owner, in one grinding season she was able to get from her sugar mills 407,000 pounds of sugar, which is a lot of sugar. But when we say she was able to get, was it her under the hot sun from Kensi to Kensi? Was it her nieces and nephews she adopted? She didn't have any children. No, it was none of them. It was the people who were enslaved there, who were enslaved over there, Africans and African Americans, several generations of people enslaved over there. That's why we have decided at the very beginning that this plantation will be a place where we will tell the story of slavery. This is the big house. This is not the focus of the visit over there. You know, Sonya, you were over there. The tour lasts about 1 hour and a half, 90 minutes, but you have only maybe 10 minutes to go through the big house. And even when you go into that big house, it will not about the story they tell you. It's not the story of the Heidels. They tell you about the domestic enslaved people, men and women, who worked in and around the big house, cooking for them, washing, cleaning, ironing. Some of them was spinners, weavers, seamstresses, midwives, and performing all kind of duties to make these people comfortable. Not only they made them wealthy, They made these people very wealthy, but also they made them very comfortable. They were very comfortable because they have these people working for them and available to their or to their needs 24 hours a day. This is a luxury. Just to give you some of the thing you can see there in the big house, this is called luxury. I didn't tell you that at the very beginning, many of these people who came from Germany and also French colonies starved. Many of them died of starvation because they had a big problem with food. They came into unfamiliar country. They didn't know much about this kind of environment. And it was the Africans who were imported into Louisiana who solved the problem. In fact, the first two slave ships that were sent to Africa, excuse me, the captains were instructed to go to countries where people know about rice cultivation. And these people, these were mostly found in what we call today Senegambia, somewhere to the south of the Gambia River, where people for maybe thousands of years knew about rice cultivation. They did not learn about rice cultivation from Chinese or whoever from Asia. It is something that is really native to West Africa. And those people solved the problem of food crop in Louisiana. 2 years after those Africans came to Louisiana, it was reported that Louisiana had enough food, enough rice for its people, and even some quantities of rice were exported to what we call today Haiti, Saint-Domingue, where most of the land was taken by, let's say, sugar cane. So the history of slavery is not only the history of hard labor and, you know, people suffering in those around those indigo vats and into sugar mills. It is also about how these Africans really contributed to saving the colony, but also contributing to the shaping of the culture. You know, these people who came over, they know about rice cultivation, but also they knew how to prepare it for food, and they influenced tremendously, not only Louisiana foodways, but, you know, Louisiana food is over everywhere in this country. The first time I ever tasted Louisiana food was in Seattle, Washington. It was something called Louisiana Wings. And the other days I was listening to NPR News, and there was something about a chef in Japan who serves gumbo in Tokyo. Yeah. And there's a lot we can really say about culture, how these enslaved Africans and their descendants really shaped the culture of this country. So these are the different people who owned the Whitney Plantation after 1860. You see, John Cummings bought it from the Formosa Chemicals and Fiber Corporation in 1999. This is John Cummings to the left. He's a lawyer. He has retired, and that's me, of course. That's my African name. And this is one of the names you find in what we call the Wall of Honor. I will come back to that later. John Cummings is a very successful lawyer, and every time he said he won a case, whatever the bartender left in his hand, he invested in real estate. And his wife calls him a dirt collector. So when he bought Whitney Plantation in 1999, he said it was just a new investment. And he said that like every white boy, he wanted to own a plantation. But once he bought it, he found out this was something really special. Because fortunately, the plantation came like a package with a study in 5 volumes about the history of the plantation, the architecture, the archaeology, and some lines about slavery on the Whitney Plantation. These volumes were financed by the Formosa Company. When that company bought the plantation, there was a lot of protests. People who were worried about the environment said, no, they are bringing some more chemicals around us. And the preservationists who knew about the site also didn't want it to be destroyed. So Formosa had to do a compromise. They decided to create what they called at the time a museum of Creole culture. They never built it, but in meanwhile, they produced these five volumes about the Whitney plantation. And when John Cummings, he started reading the lines about slavery, the chapter about slavery, he came across an inventory, and there was someone over there, a lady, who was described as a good breeder. And that's when he decided to educate himself about slavery. And that's when he decided that this place should be a place, a site of memory. And fortunately, for me and maybe for him too, I met him the next year in 2000. I just graduated from the University of Dakar, and he decided to hire me to be the director of research, because they have so many documents in Louisiana for the writing of the history of slavery, but most of the documents, more than 60%, are in French. So that's how we started to work together, and this is 17 years now. We did work together, we did work on it about 14 years before we decided to open the place. Because this is not an easy task. It is not easy to talk about slavery in this country, because the vast majority of the people are not educated about it. And they go with stereotypes, they go with all kind of misconception about slavery. And we had to be really ready and to know what we are doing. To give you an example, there is a very famous plantation in Louisiana called the Humas House. That's where you go for like weddings, the type of gone with the wind plantation, where you can also, let's say, rent the place for $30,000 to do a wedding. It is really, really a beautiful place. At the beginning, the owner decided to talk, he wanted to talk about slavery, but in his very first tour, he had so many problems with the people who were around him, mostly some of them African-American. He said he will not talk about slavery anymore. But if you cannot talk about slavery, if you don't have the knowledge or the skills, hire someone who can do it. Yeah. So this is the Whitney Plantation in 1968. You see the big house in the middle. I'm going to skip all of this and go directly to the memorials. I'm really glad that you found the word. I'm talking to you, Sonya. You said you created an architecture for grieving. Those are the right words for the Whitney Plantation. The visit starts after the introduction to the history of the plantation. We take the visitor through four memorials. And all of them, it's like going through a graveyard. It's just like going through a graveyard. But after you finish the visit of the different memorials, we take you from the cabins for the enslaved people to the big house to teach you about the real meaning of slavery. Why these people were enslaved? Why were they brought over here? How they contribute to the making of the wealth, but also how they contribute to shaping the culture. We talk about the rice growers, we talk about the cattle raisers, because the first cowboys ever that were brought into Louisiana came from Africa. Most of them were Fulani. Many of them had also a lot of knowledge about indigo production. And remember that indigo was the cash crop of Louisiana in the 18th century. These people came with a lot of agency. They were not just like we usually describe them as beasts of burden, but these people came to America because mostly of their skills. People needed their skills. That's why most of them were brought over here. But many people don't know it. I remember one time I led a tour for very wealthy people who belonged to an anti-car club. I thought that I did the best presentation ever on the Whitney Plantation, but at the end, a lady asked me a question that really struck me. He said, Dr. Seck, don't you think that these people were better off here in Louisiana instead of staying in Africa and being mistreated? And at that time, we didn't have the last memorials we just finished building. It is called the 1811 Slave Revolt Memorial. I will show you later why. That day, I wished I had that memorial ready. So this is one of the memorials we have over there. This is called Ale Gwendolyn Midler Hall. It is dedicated to all the people who were enslaved in Louisiana. Gwendolyn Midler Hall is a historian of slavery. She published in 1992 a book, Africans in Colonial Louisiana, that really helped to shape new knowledge about slavery. She's the first one who really, she was able to really show that these people had skills and a lot of agency, and they built really the colony of Louisiana. So here we have 107,000 names of people who were enslaved in Louisiana from 1819, the year of the arrival of the first slave ship, to 1820. That was the time when the domestic slave trade from the East Coast of the United States became the main provider of slave labor to the Deep South. 107,000 names on granite slabs, along with, quotes from the slave narratives that were collected in the 1930s by the Federal Writers Project. We have also what we call the Wall of Honor. The Wall of Honor is a wall dedicated to all the people who were enslaved on the Whitney Plantation, on the Hyde Plantation. And many of them, we have two sections. One side is about 18th century, people born in Africa who were deported to Louisiana, and many of them also had their African names. This is our ambassador of Senegal here in Washington, D.C. Now he moved to Tokyo, and he's pointing at one of the names that is really familiar to him. It is a Fulani name, Yero. Another memorial is dedicated to children who died in slavery. It is called the Field of Angels. Here we have 2,200 names of children who died in slavery in St. John the Baptist Parish, where the Whitney Plantation is. These are some of the slave cabins on the Whitney Plantation. Oh, when I say the Black Hydels, we have people who were born on the plantation and who were enslaved. The irony about the Whitney Plantation, the Hydel Plantation, is we don't have a single picture of the masters. Not a single picture, not a single photograph or drawing. The only people, we have two pictures of people who were born over there, but they were born in slavery. The names are over there. It was Victor Hydel and his mother, Anna. Anna, who came from the East Coast, from Virginia, and Victor Hydel was born on the Whitney Plantation in 1835. Victor was priced $800 and his mother, $100. These are the two pictures, Victor Hydel. This is the picture of Victor Hydel and his wife, Celeste Becknell. Victor and Celeste were born on the plantation from black mothers who were enslaved. And their fathers were members of the master's family. Antoine Hydel and Florestan Becknell. So this is some of the descendants of the of Victor Hydel. This is the great granddaughter of Victor Hydel, who became the first lady of New Orleans in 1978 when her husband was elected the first black mayor of New Orleans. So now we are trying to do some research about the descendants of the people who were enslaved over there. And I'm telling you, we are finding many, many people around there. The last memorial that we built is related to the German Coast Uprising in 1811, when hundreds of enslaved people decided to move, to march downriver to capture the city of New Orleans, free all the enslaved people, and maybe find a way to a free country like Haiti. I don't think they ever thought about building a free country over there. Uncle Sam would never allow it, you know. So many of them were killed in the action. They had a very weak firepower. Some of them were able to run and hide into the woods, and they became Maroons. those who were captured were taken before a very special tribunal, and dozens of them, at least 65, were condemned to death, and they were taken in front of the plantation where they belonged, in front of everybody, men, women, and children. They were shot to death. Then they were decapitated, and the heads were posted on poles. And it is a very graphic, let's say, memorial. But we had to do it. We had to tell the story. We had to. That's why I said, when that lady asked me a question about these people being bitter of in Louisiana, I wish we had this memorial ready. I would show her and ask her the question, is this being better off in this country? Here are some details of the heads. Very, they were built by Woodrow Nash. Woodrow Nash is an artist based in Akron, Ohio, and he's the same one also who built what we call the Children of Whitney. Unfortunately, I don't have those pictures over here. So these are some of the things I wanted to share with you, and maybe we can come back to this in the question and answer session. Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Dawn Lundy Martin, co-director of the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics. Thank you, Ibrahim. Thanks to Sonya for being here. Thanks to everybody for being here. So thanks to the Dietrich School, actually, for supporting this work. I should say that as co-director. But it's my pleasure, actually, tonight to introduce M. Nourbese Philip. So I first encountered M. Nourbese Philip's work when I was in graduate school and I was teaching in the language and thinking program at Bard College, which is a first year student's program where they're put through a fun but rigorous engagement with a range of texts from mathematics to animal rights, post-colonial theory to poetry. And we taught from this anthology compiled by the director of the program, and it's there where I first encountered my first Philip piece. And it's one that continues to pull me again and again. It's the long poem, Discourse on the Logic of Language. It appears in her poetry collection, She Tries Her Tongue, Her Silence Softly Breaks. Discourse on the Logic of Language is pungently haunted by an irrecoverable past. The poem makes attempts to pull something untainted, untethered from the past's depths, a way outside of anguish, which is language from the poem, but instead encounters a false narrative of linguistic naturalness. In the collection, however, Philip manages to, in her persistent seeking, unmask colonial language and lay its strategies bare. Take this moment from a poem titled Universal Grammar, for example, that examines the sentence. And this is a long moment, so I'll tell you when it's over. It's starting now. Man is, the tall man is, the tall blonde man is, the tall blonde blue-eyed man is. The tall, blonde, blue-eyed, white-skinned man is. Many factors affect and determine the order of works in a spoken sentence, the state of mind of the speaker, the gender of the speaker, his or her intentions, the context of speech, the impression the speaker wishes to make, the balance of power between speaker and listener, and, least of not all, the constraints of universal grammar. The tall, blonde, blue-eyed, white-skinned man is shooting. The smallest cell remembers a sound, sliding two semitones to return home. That's the end of that excerpt. I wish I could show you this poem, and also Discourse on the Logic of Language and the way they textually inhabit the page, the punctuation, the attention to topography. I wish I could play it for you like a song I've only told you about. Sonya Posmentier implicitly asks in her New York Times piece, A Language of Grieving, which is, you know, what really brought us to tonight through Lauren, she asks,
Can poetry, unlike the social and legal articulation of grief, make violence strange and unfamiliar, thereby in the very act of utterance, enact something other, counter in violence instead? Philip's poetry reaches beyond language itself into her stunning attempts and do just this. What does it mean to untell a story, she asks in the notanda section, the note section at the end of Zong, her book-length monument or anti-monument that apparaticizes the grief of the slave trade in the middle passage and its brutality and its humanness. The barbaric nature of humanness and the material grief that accompanies it. M. Nourbese Philip is a Toronto-based poet, writer, and lawyer originally from Tobago. Her many distinctions include fellowships from the Guggenheim Foundation, Bellagio, the McDowell Colony, as well as the Casa de las Americas Prize, Cuba. Author of the poetry collection, She Tries Her Tongue, Her Silence Softly Breaks, and the novels Looking for Livingstone, An Odyssey of Silence, and Harriet's Daughter. Philip is best known for her poetry collection, Zong, which relies on the text of the late 18th century legal decision, Gregson versus Gilbert, concerning the murder of 150 Africans on the titular slave ship. It is my honor, my pleasure, to introduce to you and to welcome M. Nourbese Philip. Please join me.
Thank you. Si. Ato. Trayvon. Sandra. Eric. Nkrumah, Ato, Sisi, Nompulela, the truth was the ship sailed. The rains came. The loss arose. The truth is the ship sailed. The rains came. The loss arose. The Negroes is. The truth was. Nkrumah. Ato. No banzi. Odumeye. Opa. Fagulu. No banzi. Fagbulu. Zong, number 15. Defend the dead. Weight of circumstance. Ground to usual and etc. Where the ratio of just in less than is necessary to murder. The subject in property, the save in underwriter, where etc. tunes justice and the ratio of murder is the usual in occurred. Akila. The just in ration, the suffer in loss, defend the dead, the weight in circumstance, ached in necessary, the ration in just. Age the act in the our way to justice. Masire, Ndale, Omowunmi, Ramla, Ajani, Zong number 16, should they have, should they have, should they have, should they have found being sufficient, should they have, should they have, should they have found being sufficient a necessity? Portion that question. Should they have found the justify for exist? A rule for new, the policy within the loss. Portion that question, etc. Should they? Might they have found being? Should they have? Should they have? Should they have? Should they have found being sufficient? Should they have? Should they have? Should they have? Should they have found being sufficient? Should they have found? Should they have found being? Might they have found? Nompumulelo, okulaja, ekisola, arike, arike. Should they have? Might they have? Should they have? The off, and during, and wherefore, the preserving, the insurance of water, the within loss, the terms of exist, a Negro of wit, should they have found, should they have found water and being sufficient? They have, should they have, should they have Tulolope, should they have Suma, should they have Okunola, should they have Khalifa, should they have, should they have, should they have whom? Should they have Sisi? Might they have? Should they have? Should they have found being and water sufficient? Should they have? Might they have? Should they have this necessity of loss, this quantity of not perils, underwriters, insurers of the throw in circumstance, the instance in attempt, the attempt in voyage, the may in become. What should they have? Should they have? Should they have? Might they have? The may in become. In. The between of day. The between of day. A sea of Negroes drowned. Live in the thirst. Should they have? Might they have? Should they have? Should they have Oriome? Should they have Fasui? Should they have Olaifa? Should they have Ekua? Should they have Bobo? Should they have Kobi? In the between of day, a sea of Negroes drowned. Should they have? Should they have? Should they have? For otherwise, the shore of verdict in the want of action preserve the soon in afterwards the time in Africa to Jamaica. Should they have? 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 Now the question falls upon enemies. Should they have? Should they have? Kusuro Moleye Namona Ufa Bila. Should they have? 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 Of them, the way, broad and wide as it was. Long I won her fair. The pig got to the east and west over the seas to sin. Am I a man of wit? Ruth, I hear you say, some see the dove on wing, the red cove, the red, le sang, le, sing le son, el son, oh God, no. Hug and tug my she, run ma he, run ma ba, ba, ia, they ran, the cot, the cat, what gut, are we sugs? All gut, her. No, no, no. Run if you hear. Dogs hide the gods. Run if you hear. Dogs hide the gods. Are gone done. For hey and hola run round and round, sound of dog, of song there is. Plus it rains, sip, sip, sup, and doze, a dose of clap. Suppose the hat rode the rat round and round. The fins heard them. The crew does my bid, no sound. Bell, song, lure. Her dong, she dives dong to the rim, over with you and under she. All's falling. All's falling. Appears under. Water found. Africa. A rose. Round and round. The hat. The rat. The water. Oh. The rot. Sought them new. Rules state the test. Man for men and for tea. Ruth asked Rome. Fist to the head, miss. Fortune's tune pain. Turn and turn round the globe. Build a bell and bell. The cat she was. Torn we sear and singe the rose. Of Afrique, a mole on the nape of her neck. A bill of sail flap. Flap. In the wind, the sail. Seal. The sail sad. Sails night, fall so far to Afrique and the dog star. The salt la, Selassa, Elsa listen la, Sansa. In the E, yes, saltai. Nda, ha, yes, saltun. De the na, eels, sal. Tin the A, it in the no. Say salt on the s, saz, ah. Ult in the no. Say salt on the s. Kin saltum, the skull, in of the yabo, yabo, nesal, the sk, im the skull, in of the say, ah, for the two, ruds, the what, as of cup, in the trap, of rear, sun binds you, sin the net of time waves. Kim, the school, Muff Prof, it's their cup. In long, low, in long, low. Abo, the, everyone, et to bay, et all that to, a sound, rough honor, ill the shape, Negroes too stern. Men of stay, me, and we are. And we run our lee, thus by bo, el and go, in the rings, solve sin. In the rings, so sin grow. In the rings, 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 in the rings.
Losing my voice, but you all have pieces of paper or sheets from Zong. This will be just a couple of minutes because I always like to end it with us reading together because it takes the work back to where it came from in the first place, which is community. No, academics don't like to read out loud, but I've had some great success recently. Some of you have little pieces. I call them pieces of Zong. Just pick a line or read what is there. Some of you have entire sheets. And the important thing here is we're not all reading from the same page, which is a lesson. Now, some of you don't have them here in the front, I believe. I have some pieces which I can share. Anybody needs a piece of Zong? Someone's water for the ancestors. Thank you. Would you like a piece? These are little pieces, in fact, to give you a couple. So we'll just start. A couple of minutes, no more. There's something interesting that happens when you hear the voices all coming together. Shall we start? Fresh air. Omi, water, the hag, Circe, And this is a collective reading, so I want to hear the voices. Fresh air, Omi, water, the hag, Circe, mates, Circe, a ring of stones in the sand, her old men's have no song. All sound they sing off the pact of pain, pact of pain, pact of pain, pact of pain, pact of pain. Pact of pain. Thank you all, that was wonderful. Thank you very much.
So I think we're gonna transition to a conversation, a sort of brief conversation. Yeah, thank you. I had a set of questions going in, now I have another set of questions, but I think in the interest of time, I'll maybe just open with one question and then we'll open it out. One thing I thought we might talk about is the idea of repair or reparation. I think both of your work has been talked about in those terms. And I wonder what you see as the function of poetry or history in reparation, and how poetic or historical repair relates to maybe the way we more often think about reparations in material and economic terms.
One of the working titles I have used for Zong, performances of Zong, is the movable shrine, in the sense that wherever the work is performed, it creates a shrine, which is a sacred place, and that within that space, there is potentiality for repair. When you say the word reparations, it has a certain connotations in the world we live in today. And I think there are many kinds of reparations. I think if we understand what has been broken and fragmented and torn, then we can understand what it is that needs to be repaired. I happen to think that there's some kinds of reparation. I say spiritual, but I put it in quotation marks, the word, because again, it's so loaded, that only we can give ourselves. There's no government or state or any official body that can ever repair. I mean, there are certain material things that will help in that repair, But essentially, there's a place, a point, and which is where I think poetry comes in. There's a point at which only we can repair that for ourselves. And there are many ways of coming at it, art, poetry. And I think also, you talked about that, you used that quote from me, that space, that gap. What do we do in that space? And it seems to me that one of the, I think Zong, what is happening in Zong is not happening in the words, it's happening in the spaces. It's how we articulate those spaces, how we read what. So what, I say the work performs me in the sense that I don't consider myself a performer, and what comes up, comes up. And it's in those spaces, if I let myself be open, it's in those spaces that something happens. So at the end there, rings, oh, it seemed to me that there was a, it was a song of pain, but it was also moving into some sort of celebration and a kind of worship or genuflection to something larger. That's how I mean, those are a few preliminary comments.
Heard that.
About.
Thoughts about that?
Reparations.
Yeah.
It is a very difficult topic. What made it, I think, very difficult is whenever you say reparation, people think about a big check that someone has to put on every black hand. When we say reparation, that means something was broken. Some people were affected by slavery. But you know, you have to start at the very beginning with the origins of the people who were enslaved all over the Western Hemisphere. Where they came from, how did they become what? Captives, like me, captured in warfare or kidnapped somewhere on some village. Who was involved? Who was between those people who went around and kidnapped people? Or who initiated those, that permanent warfare on the soil of Africa? Who was behind putting fire? What should be the attitude of the Africans toward the question, with the question of slavery? Don't we need some in-house cleansing in Africa? We need to be educated first about slavery. It is a very complicated affair. We have to know about the people, how they were packed in those dungeons in Africa, and then the Middle Passage, and then they arrived here in America, enslaved. They made people wealthy. They contributed to making to the of the culture. And then one day they said slavery is over, 1865. Was it really over? What happened after that? Reconstruction was a real myth. Nothing was ever reconstructed. Nothing was repaired. Instead, slavery was reinvented under another name. The same game but different names. I think they call it Jim Crow around here. And I think slavery did not only affect the people, the victims, the real victims. Look at the people also who are on the side of the master. Something was wrong in the minds of the people who had dominated the society. And that thing, was it transmitted from generation to generation? What about that person over there who was supposed to enforce the law and who does racial profiling? You have a lot of problems, you have a lot of things to learn and to understand. That's why I think we do not need to hurry. We have to do a good study of the problem in order to find a real solution. But I think it will start with education. Educate our people, no matter the color of the skin. We need to understand why did it happen. We need to understand a lot. And I think most of us are not really educated about this mess. And if you don't know about the problem, how can you solve it? And it is not only the work of historians. Everybody has to be involved, poets, lawyers, people who know about the economy, because it is a very complicated affair. It's only at the end, when we get really educated about it, that we can think about how to repair the problem. But education comes first.
Thank you.
Voila.
Yeah. So that was a really big question to start with, but maybe people have follow-ups, places to go from here.
Anyway? Can you speak more to Whitaker Nash's statues that are at the Whitney and how they're incorporated with the WPA narratives?
Okay. Were you at Whitney? Did you ever go there?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. So, I missed the most important thing on Whitney Plantation. The children of Whitney. I don't know how the slide went, but it was there. Woodrow Nash, he was last weekend on Whitney Plantation for the inauguration of the 1811 slave revolt. You know, he also built those heads with ceramic. The children of Whitney are built with clay. And what is the inspiration? It is from FWP slave narratives. When in the middle of the Depression, they sent those people who had education but would lose their jobs, historians and young scholars, to go around and collect stories from everyday Americans, including black people. And soon they found out among those black people, some of them once were enslaved on plantations all over the US South. And it is just wonderful. This is a corpus of knowledge about slavery that any other country in the world has at its disposition. It is unique. But you see, most of those testimonies were from people who were maybe 90 years old or maybe 100 and plus years old. And the memories of slavery they were still carrying with them were the memories of their childhood. That's why we decided to represent them as children, not as senior people. And that's how we came up with the concept of the children of Whitney. And fortunately, John Cummings met Woodrow Nash. You know, I think he still does it every year. He goes to Jazz Fest to sell his art, to present his art. And that's when John Cummings started to talk to him, and they came up with this idea to build, you know, those children of Whitney. And he did a good job. And when John hired him to do the job, he said, "I will do my best in order to allow these children to breathe life all over the plantation." And when you go over there, your first encounter is with the what they call the children of Whitney. They give you a ticket. On one side is a picture of the child, and on the other side is a quote, a testimony of that child telling you what was it meant to be a slave on a plantation like the Whitney Plantation or elsewhere. And it is, like I told you, it is not easy to talk about slavery. When you get into the plantation, and we let you know that most of the things you learn about slavery is from these children. It opens your heart. Even if you are, you know, among the greatest people, most of the people who don't know anything about slavery and who come with those stereotypes, it opens your heart, whatever the color of your skin, and you are willing to learn. And I think it is a very good strategy, because people, when they come to the plantation, they always shake your hand and say, thank you for educating me, you know, black and white people. It's not easy. It's not really easy. Let me give you an example. How to talk to people like you have the black idols watching you and listening to you, the white idols, these are not of the masters, you know. How can you talk to all of these people and not generate any kind of conflict or whatever? It's through education, and also it's through, I think, mainly the fact that we tell to the people, we learn today about slavery through the eyes of these children. And the quotes are everywhere on the plantation, on the wall of honor dedicated to the people who enslaved there, on Whitney. On the Gwendolyn Middlehall Alley is dedicated to all the people who enslaved in Louisiana. The Field of Angels, dedicated to children. You find those quotes everywhere. And if that's why we allow people to go back to the memorials in order to read more and to learn more about slavery. I think the children of Whitney is a very good idea. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's interesting because I hadn't thought about it for a while, but I went to Whitney just a few months after the Kerouac exhibit, or I guess it was about a year. And those children kind of were like a counter to the melting and disintegrated and amputated children.
And one thing in many instances, you know, we have children who come with their parents. Mm-hmm. One time we have a family, white people, and there was a little girl, she went around, you know, kissing and hugging all these little black children, just like they were real. Mm-hmm.
Do you have another question? Time? For a couple more. Yeah. Maybe get the mic. Yeah.
Hi. Thank you so much. And that was absolutely beautiful. I was thinking a little bit, especially with the way Carol Walker watched the audience during A Subtlety, as kind of, you know, the artist almost as specter, right? And like kind of watching after the fact. And I'm wondering about, because in both of your work, you are watching the people that are engaging in the work that you've created, whether they be tourists or people listening to the reading of poetry. And sharing and like as sharing how Carol Walker felt. I mean, she's not here to talk about that, but you're both here in a sense of perhaps what it is to look an audience in the eyes.
I mean, for me, it's an important question that links to my trying to get the audience to read at the end together, because I think what it does is for the moment breaks down that gap between spectator and performer, spectator, audience, that we're all in this together, which I think links to some of what Ibrahim is saying. So that I'm thinking, and Dawn raised this last night, I realized that the whole theme of this is grief, and every year on the anniversary of this particular tragedy, I stage a durational reading over several hours of the entire book, where myself and the audience, we read sometimes with musicians, dancers, and so on. And I think that there's something, for me at least, in those performances, I give up something to the audience, so to speak. It's not me performing the work. We are in this
together. And there's something about that process. By the end of it, those who remain to the end, that there's a transformational energy that happens. That I haven't quite worked out what it is yet, but I know in terms of the actual performance that it's, I sometimes involve the audience. I did a performance last week in Toronto, and I had a pile of white cloths, and so I would be giving the cloths to audience members, and who do I choose to give the cloth to? Why did I choose to give it to you and not you, and so on. So there's a very intricate, something about relationship. I'm reading Glissant now, and so I'm thinking about relationship a lot. And there's something about relationship, and in terms of what was said here earlier, how do we establish relationship so that we're not in these systems of power, that we can actually see the other and see the pain of the other in ourselves. A very interesting happened at the last reading, the last duration performance. A woman wrote to me after and said, I was very upset because I thought I heard some white people saying the N-word. And I thought, I don't think I have the N-word in the book, but, you know, she's a black woman. And anyway, so I wrote her back, and then I said to her, I asked her, I said, well, tell me what would have, I think she was sitting next to a couple of white people, and we're reading this text, the words are there. And I asked her what would make her more comfortable, and she never responded to me. But I was genuinely interested because I'm thinking, if you would prefer to sit next to people of your own race, for instance, or whatever, then we, you know, I'm willing, in fact, want to talk about that. But I think even the offer of telling me what would make you comfortable or less uncomfortable. So there are those kinds of issues that arise around audience and performance.
I mean,
I know, go ahead, say something.
Well, I was going to ask you just, I guess, a kind of related question, which is I was so interested in when you were talking about reading the volume, the historical volumes, and coming upon something that made him change what he was thinking about what to do with the space, right? And I couldn't get out of my head what made him that kind of reader, that he could read that history in that way, or that he could have that moment, which I think relates to the question of audience in some way, or reading. How do we make more people read in that way, or how do we invite that kind of reading, that he could read that one line? And maybe why don't other people read that one line and have that same response?
I think that we have different experiences. And let me give you the example of what you call talent. You know, every person has something in him or her. But to get started and to turn that talent into something that is visible and useful to yourself and to the people around you in your society, you need a spark. Where can you get that spark? It may be a good teacher. It may be an uncle or whatever, or whoever. But I think in the case of slavery, too, we have different sensibilities. We have different experiences. And we don't interact with writings. We don't all interact with writings like the same way, you know. Let me give you some example. For example, when the people come to the plantation, we have sometimes whole families that come. You have black people, white people. Some people are from Africa, from India, from Japan. Okay? But there's something universal about people suffering. If you take the example of children, I think any person who stand over there before you and tell him that if this particular child lived on this plantation in 1831 or 1832, his childhood would end officially at age 10 by the virtue of law. The 1825 Civil Code of Louisiana made it clear when you reach the age of 10, childhood is over. They can sell you wherever they want it, whenever they want it. They put you to the plow, things like that. Some people I think everybody should be touched with that kind of thing. What about reading about, a young woman, you come across information, a young woman on an inventory. Her name was Seri, 25 years old, sold to someone for $105. 25 years old. Why? Because the archive says, the judge who was also not republic put over there one single word that make you understand why she was sold $105. They put idiot. And someone bought that person described as an idiot because she's a woman and she's 25 years old. You know, those things, that make you think, why did it happen? Beyond the word idiot, you may also think that someone bought her because she could be used for something else. I don't need to go into details, So those are the kind of things, people have different sensibilities. You come across on information that really struck you and make you willing to learn more and more, okay? I think that's what happened to John Cummings. He was not educated about slavery. He knew, he said, that people were enslaved all over the country, but he didn't know how depraved they were. And that's something you can learn by reading those slave narratives or by reading the information you get from the archives.
Mm-hmm. I hate to cut off this wonderful conversation. Our time is running short, but please join us outside for the book signing and join me in thanking our guests tonight.
Thank you. Thank you.